Thank you, Lord. Bless this time in Jesus' name.
Hey, good morning, City Limits family and friends. So nice of you to join our service today. Before we get started, we have a couple of announcements. The first one is, if you have children, you're going to want to check out the videos that our children's pastor, she's also our youth pastor, our children's pastor puts up online on our Facebook. This week, she has one with puppets even. And each week, she does either a biblical story or just a good story on how to be moral and whatnot with biblical standards. So I encourage you, if you have children, this is their church time while we are in this situation. The second announcement is, in a couple of weeks, we're going to be starting a couple of classes. We're going to do that over Zoom. And if you don't know how to use Zoom, just call the office, and we will show you how to do that. We'll help you through that. Okay, so we have some stuff coming up, and we're very glad you've joined us. We're going to pray, but we also have two prayer requests, and we're going to pray for them as we open the service. Lord, we thank you so much for the opportunity to meet, even if it's technologically. We just thank you, Lord. Lord, you see these prayer requests. We pray for Rita's Uncle David, who's in the hospital, had a very long surgery, and her aunt, who most likely is very worried about him. Lord, will you bring a complete healing to his body? All that the surgeons did, God, we ask that it would work perfectly and that he would be as good as new. We also pray for this lady, Michelle Cajasso, I believe is her last name. She was hit by a tractor trailer, Lord, and is not in good condition. She is awake, but she is needing a lot of help. Lord, will you touch her body? Cause the doctors to have divine wisdom. Show them exactly what to do to bring her back to a place of complete health. And Lord, we just give you this service. We thank you, Lord, for technology. We thank you for this season in our lives where we can still follow you, worship you, just love you. And Lord, we give you this service completely. May you anoint everything that happens here and touch each and every life that is hearing and participating. In the wonderful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. I want you to worship the Lord. Worship lightly if you'd like. You know, so just thank you for being here this morning. It's good to have some people back in the house. Sister Ruthie, Pastor Ray, David's out of the hospital. Good. It's good to have you. It's so good to have you. Good to have you here. Sonia. Stretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing.
Forever God is faithful. rising sun, the setting sun, His love endures forever. And by the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For He is good, He is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. Come on, church. Sing praise. Give the Lord a hand. Thank you, Jesus. Everybody at home, God bless you. Praise the Lord. Take a minute to lift your hands and just thank the Lord wherever you are. Thank you, Jesus, for your love and for your mercy. We give you praise.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life, there's a better life. If you've got pain, if you feel lost, He's a way maker. night. We've all run to things we know that just ain't right. No, they're not, but there's a better life. There's a better life. If you've got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify, testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. Oh, my Lord, if you believe it.
Thank you, Lord. We give you praise. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
I'm alive because he lives.
Father, we thank you for this day, Lord. Thank you to all of you that are out there at home. And just, we pray for you and know that we miss you. And just thank you for those that are here today. Lord God, we thank you for them. And pray that you will be with us, Lord, and be with our country right now, Lord, as there is so much hurt and pain, Lord God. And Father, this is when we need you the most, Lord. This is why you came. Because there's chaos and you wanted to turn peace, joy, and eternal life from that death and chaos. And so we thank you now, Lord, and pray your blessing upon the word, Lord, upon the offering, upon everything that we do. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Amen. Give the Lord a hand. Amen. You may be seated.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, everybody. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. It is so good. It's such a beautiful day. All the windows are open here. I can't wait until you come and see the sanctuary and see that we've got it all quarantined off. There's some rules now, you know, to stay clean and to wear a mask. I'm back here because I'm about 10 or 12 feet away from the first person or the person I don't live with anyway. So we're all trying to be safe and practice safety, okay? There's a little spike going on now. And so all we have to do is be safe, you know, and care for each other. And our reason for it is not that we're scared, okay? Because I know many of you hug me already. and I've been hugged by people and hug people. Just it's that our job is to protect our sheep and to protect you. So if you don't feel safe and comfortable yet, this is going to be online. We're going to be doing live all the time, and if you see me now kind of shift over a little bit and move finally after 100 days of being still, you know, Pastor Jimmy, it's pretty hard. It's because there's some people here, and I may just lean over just a little bit, not too far. Okay, so thank you, Lord, for a wonderful day. Let me get my technology to work for me. You know how it is with me. I have my Bible here, okay? Get your Bibles, and get your Bibles ready and give me a moment just to make sure that my computer will stay on when I go. Okay. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Is there a testimony out there, anybody? Come on, I'll repeat it for you. I just love seeing people, bodies, seeing people in this church. Oh, thank you so much. Thank you so much for being here. And thank you to all of you that are out there and to our friends. We've got friends from Jersey and out in New York and stuff like that, in Long Island, North Carolina. One came from out in Dubai. So I've been trying to learn how to do FaceTime. It gives you a translator so you can translate it into Spanish and into other languages. So going to see how that works out and see what it does for us, okay? Anyway, praise the Lord. Let's get to the word of God today. Father, we thank you for your word, and we pray that you will be with us, Lord, and just bless us. Could someone give me a water, please? Be with us and just bless your word, Lord God. And we thank you for all the work that's been being done around here, all the construction, all the cleaning and everything, all the prayers, all the support, all your pastors, all the background work, all the puppets. I put that early this morning. Oh, I was going to put it early this morning. I didn't put it there because Debbie said it was too early. But I was going to put to take a look at Pastor Sherry and her ministry for the kids, families. Take time to sit and watch that with them, okay? 25, 30 minutes and watch it and see what they learn and ask them, talk to them about it because it's always a life lesson, something that we need to hear. Excuse me for a moment. I want you to turn in your Bibles to the book of Luke. Chapter 15, Luke chapter 15, a story that we all know well, but I wonder how well we know it. Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to be reading a little bit from the message here today because it's got a special nuance that makes it sound good to me, okay? It just feels good. He adds a few words there, not that they're in the word, but that they give you the feeling of what's going on in context, okay? In the book of Luke, chapter 15, verses 11 through 14, is a little portion of the story of the prodigal son, which takes up a whole lot of chapter 15. Also, a few chapters down is the reason why Jesus is even telling all these parables. And I want to clue you into that because that's the reason why he's sharing this story. It says, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, thank you for your word. Father in heaven, bless our hearts now to be open to you, to receive from you. Help our hearts, Lord God. It's been a while, 100-something days, a few months now it's going on, that we have not been in close fellowship, in eyeball fellowship, seeing each other, holding, touching each other, singing with each other. And that can bring on a loneliness. It can bring on a separation. So I just pray that this message today will minister to your heart. If you're challenged by it, then I pray that at the end, as I pray, that you will pray with me and let's get back in the game. In Jesus' name, amen. In the book of Luke, chapter 15, verses 11 through 14, says, so then Jesus said to them, there was a man who had two sons. The younger said to his father, Father, I want all now that's coming to me. I want it right now. I want now what's coming to me. So the father, he divided his property between them, his son, his older son and the younger son. And it wasn't long before the stranger's son packed his bags and left to a distant country. There, undisciplined and separated, he wasted everything he had. After he had gone through all his money, there was a bad famine all through that country, and he began to feel hurt. I don't want to tell you all the rest of the story, but I want to share this with you. I remember my life when, you know, my title of this is, you know, I need a change. I need a change, Lord. You know, I need to change. And how does that happen? Well, first I have to take a real good look at what's happened in my life and how did I get to where I am, that I'm lonely and I'm tired and I'm homeless and everything else. And as I think of the park bench I was found on, I can only think of that my prayer to the Lord was, Lord, I need a change. I need a change. And I used to beg for change, if you can imagine that. But I remember I was in Teen Challenge. I got down on a chair. I was praying. I had to pray every morning a half hour prior to getting our oatmeal. And I said, Lord, I need a change. If you could spare some change. But the change I was talking about, it wasn't money. It wasn't money. It was a change in my life, something that would change me forever. And so I wanted to share this with you, that there's four downward steps that we can see in this whole thing of the prodigal son. Now, I know that you've heard it before. I know that you've heard it before out there online, right? But I want to share a twist at the end with you that I think might show us why. First of all, let me give you some context. In about chapter 14 of the Pharisees, they're seeing Jesus and he's healing a man on a Sabbath. They said, why do you heal a man on a Sabbath? It's not the right day. It's the Lord's day, a Shabbat. You know, we don't heal on the Sabbath. And Jesus says to them, which one of you who has a son or maybe an ox, an animal that, I don't know, that treads for you and plows for you, how many of you who has a son or an animal on the Sabbath, on a Saturday, and he falls into a ditch, how many of you are not going to go in to get him? Because he wants to see, how religious are you? How lawful are you? Because these men were like lawyers. They were like, they knew the law, man. They knew the law. They knew what was right. They knew what was wrong. I mean, they were caught up in it, and you mix that into the religion, and boy, it was either you're doing it or you're sinning, or you're doing it right or you're not doing it at all. So Jesus begins to tell them these stories in that context that they are saying, this man eats with sinners. This man is healing on the Sabbath, right? And so there's four steps to go downward. When I think of it, I go kayaking, and I know sometimes I'll be out there, and getting a little older, my arms will get tired, and man, I just pause for a few minutes, and I realize that when I stop paddling, I start going backwards. I start following that river. Why I say that is because I usually don't go downhill. If I'm trying to practice and work out, I go uphill a little bit. It's not a strong river, but I try to go up because I want to fight a little bit, you know? But I found out that if I stop, I just start going downhill. And here on Front Street, there's a dam. So you don't want to go downhill that much. You want to go up. So if I ever really got tired, I go sideways and go to the beach or to the just step in the mud and get out. But there's four steps that take you downward. And the first one is found in 12. In verse 12 in the Message, it says, I want it right now. I want it right now. And what's the first thing? If you're taking notes, the first one is selfishness is the first thing that starts to drive you down. Selfishness. You know, during this pandemic, I see people with like tons of paper. I found out somebody had some of the little squirt things with the sanitizer. And I saw somebody just grab them all. And they got their arm around and some were falling out, but they just couldn't get enough. Let me get them all. Right? Let me get them all. And that selfishness is the first part that you've stopped thinking about others and are only thinking about yourself. Can I get an amen for that? Amen. According to Jewish law, it said that an eldest son is supposed to receive twice as much as anyone else in the family. So this is the younger son. He's just getting half of what he's got, but he takes it, right? I mean, and it was okay. A lot of people say, no, it wasn't okay to take it until the father's dead. But it was okay. In Deuteronomy, it speaks of that. Now, here's what happens. He asked for his portion. Give me whatever I'm supposed to have. Right, what's he saying with that? He's saying, Dad, when you die, I get so much. Give it to me now. I want it right now. I mean, is that selfish, man? That's like saying, Dad, listen, I consider you as dead right now. I need what is mine now. I got some stuff on my mind. I have some things on my, I've got a plan, I've got an agenda, and I want to get that done, and I can't wait until you die and I get my portion. So you give me mine now. That would be hurtful to me, right? I mean, wait till I die. I mean, my God, is it the last breath? I shoot some more morphine in them, you know, just, you know what I mean. I know I'm making light of it, but just, you know. It was pretty legal. In the book of Luke 12:15, it says, take heed, beware of your covetousness. For a man's life, it consists not of the abundance of the things that he possesses, but it can, listen to me, it depends on who you are, on what you are. And we account so much to how much people have. The car I'm driving, or on my jewelry, or my watch, or my phone, or my this, or my that, or my house, how big is my house, what I have, you know, all that. That's how we start to calculate people now. Well, we give them value according to what they have, because that to us is success, but not to the believer. It's how much I'm loving God, how much God is loving me. God gives me the peace that passes all understanding. Even if I have nothing at the end of the day, but I have Jesus, I'm still safe. I got a roof over my head and some food in the refrigerator. I am fine. The second thing that can show that you are starting to drift, and why am I sharing this? Because I know that we've been away 100 days, 100 plus days now. It's gone a few months. Right, January, February, March, April, May, June, almost going on 5 months. And I know that this can happen to us. You know, we can get kind of in our home, and I'm in my house, and what do I need and what do we need? And we can get a little selfish, okay? Maybe not you, maybe just me, right? I mean, we can get a little selfish, right? You know. So the second thing is in verse 13, he says, and he went to a distant country, a faraway country. He went to a distant country. And that to me is the second sign of beginning to fall away, which is to be separated. Anybody follow me? I get separated. I don't want to be with them anymore. I don't want to look into their eyes. I don't want to hang with them anymore. I don't want to be close. I don't want nobody to come visit me. I, I, I'd rather be alone. Why? Because there's stuff on your mind. I go to a far country. I want to be away. I want to do the things I want to do. I want to do some things I can't do in front of you, and I can't do it here. I know people that when they go on vacation, they say, oh, it's okay to drink and smoke a little bit, party, dance, and do what you want. And I'm not judging any of you. What I'm saying is think about what you're saying. I would never do this in front of you, but when I go away and I'm 1,000 miles away and nobody knows me, I'll do some stuff that I wouldn't do in front of you. Forgive me. Think that Jesus is there with you, and how would he feel? So he goes to a faraway country, and there he finds his heart. He finds his heart. He starts to do things. He's got money. And while he's got money, you know, he's got friends, and we all know that. You know, I mean, while you got a dollar in your pocket, there's a buddy on the other side. But the minute that you're broke, you're by yourself. And we all know that happens in life. He was distant from God. He was distant in his heart. He was distant from his father. He was distant from his family. He was distant from his lifestyle. Hallelujah. The third thing that happens, and I want to go over them with you again to make sure that you got, first of all, is that we get selfish a little bit. Self-centered. You say, well, I'm not selfish. I give. I'm not selfish. I'm kind. I'm not selfish. I'm not talking about that. Think of you personally in your soul and in your spirit. Are you kind of more worried about you than everything else now? You see, up till last night, 115,000 people have died in America. Who shed a tear? Who shed a tear? Last night. Anybody know what happened last? I'm sorry, 2 days ago in the morning. In the evening, there was a man, and it's in Atlanta, Georgia. Atlanta, Georgia is known as, like, it's the pride of many black people because it's very successful, and they're doing movies there now. People are very, very well educated, a good community. And so a man is at a Wendy's, and the man does something. He runs from police, and the police catch up. Two police get him. It's all on video. They surround him, and the guy, he didn't pass a sobriety test. And they get him, and they knock him down. And the guy, still drunk, is strong enough to pull his way around, knock them both down, and take the guy's taser. He runs down the parking lot. Somebody's still videoing this. He turns around and points a taser at the cop, and the cop shoots him 3 times and kills him. So last night, they burnt that Wendy's down, which has got 2 gas stations on each side. And the flames are coming over. Anybody follow me? And the flames are coming all over the place. And they're thinking, oh, my, what can happen here? A selfishness, man. I mean, people just are separated. And they're senseless. Listen to this. In verse 13, it says, here's the third thing that could show you that that somebody is starting to drift away or that you're drifting. It says that he wasted everything. Okay, in the KJV or in others, he squandered all he had. He squandered it all. Everything he had gotten from his father, his portion, is now lost. It's now gone. He spent it all. He had friends. Now he has nobody. And what I call this is senseless. You weren't thinking. You're not thinking of the consequences of what's going to happen as you go out there. Sometimes all of us will get a blessing and you want to be kind and generous and go out and do things, and you got to think that there's going to be a tomorrow. Some people don't think like there's a tomorrow. They're like this. I want to gratify myself right now. I just want to be gratified right now. I don't care about anything else. And we have to think long term, folks. This is going to pass. People are going to want Jesus. See the people here now? There's going to be more people. People that we don't know. Seriously, people that we don't know are going to come in because they need something than being selfish. They need something more than being self-centered. They know that they're beginning to drift, that their mind, man, if the devil just kind of pulls your mind, he just makes you think about that, and then you think about it, and then you think about it. And when sin is finally conceived or gives birth to sin, you see something that draws you away, draws your mind away, and you're thinking, why? Because I'm not in fellowship. That's why these sermons, that's why all of the children's stuff is important, church. Watch Pastor Sherry's stuff, all the prayer requests. Pastors do that. Watch them. Join a Zoom class. Get involved. And don't watch everything on YouTube. So he's senseless. We can see his downward spiral there.
The four steps, number one is that he's selfish. He begins to get selfish. He's separated from the people that he's supposed to be with. He's senseless in the way that he does things. He made bad choices. And the fourth thing is, it says in verse 14, and he began to be hurt. It says in others, and then he began to hunger because he had squandered everything he had. So this one I call, he began to be starving. He began to need something more inside of him. He began to need something inside of him. And I'm not just talking about food as well, but there was something missing. All the other things are going to come around. Now, as soon as you get to starving and living on a park bench, just like me, all the other stuff comes along and you realize, I don't have friendships. I don't have anybody I can call. I burned all my bridges. I did everything. When you get to starving is when you find out that I got to go search inside a dumpster or something to find food, or I got to beg on a street corner or in a park because I just don't know anybody who will trust me anymore. Or I'm too proud, even at such a low stake, to go ask somebody who might help me. So he does the unthinkable now. He joins on and he glues himself to a citizen of that land to feed pigs. Now, what a nice thing for an Israeli boy to do. Feeding swine. Anybody follow me? It says, and it got to the point to where he was eating the pig pods too. So, I mean, here's a person that you can see how far they've fallen. They had everything with their father. Everything they had. They had everything already for them. And yet he wanted to try something else. It was something that was calling. That sinful nature inside of us that said, it might be greener on the other side. And it's not. It's not. Anybody follow me? So there's these steps that come down and you see them. It says in the book of John chapter 8, verse 34 and 36 in the message, and Jesus said, I tell you most solemnly that anyone who chooses a life of sin is trapped in a dead-end life. And as is, in fact, even becomes a slave. A slave is a transient who cannot come and go at will. The Son, though he established a position, the run of the house, So if the Son has set you free, then you are free indeed. Think about that, man. I mean, just as we think that that we're free, and we think that we're free. And I remember when I was an addict, and somebody would say, "Hey, do you want to go to the beach for the day?" And I would say, "No, I can't do it." Right? Because I knew if I took a day off, I got to get, my whole mission in the morning is I got to get something to get me right at night or I won't be able to sleep. So I couldn't even have fun. Hey, do you want to go play with your kid? No, I got to do something. Everything. You want to spend time here with your wife? No, I can't. I want to go see your parents today. Can't do that. Don't have time. I can't do that. I've got son. I've fallen in love with something else. Something else has made me a slave to it in my heart. Are you following me? And time alone, time separate, time being selfish, time thinking only of you, this is what will happen. And we need to keep that Christ-centered mindset, you know, that I am here because God has placed me here just like an Esther for such a time as this so that the world could know that God is alive. They don't need to be hearing. They're even trying to get God out of prayer, God out of everything. And we need to be that shining light that will not go out. There will be no bushel on my head. I will not hide myself. I will not blow my light out. I want to be on fire for God because people are going to need Jesus. Even though people say that they don't, they're going to need Jesus. And we need to be the ones to let them know. Are you feeling selfish? Are you feeling lonely? Are you feeling by yourself? Are you feeling like you're hungry? Are you starving inside for love and for peace and for joy? Or for even just a sense of purpose? Then maybe you need Jesus. Because when he sets you free, you'll be free indeed. When he satisfies you, you'll be satisfied with just knowing, I have Jesus. I have everything. And he will supply all my need according to his riches in glory. So just as I found four ways that take you downward, I want to show you four that take you up. Sounds pretty simple, but I've got a catch at the end. Got a little hook at the end I want you to pay attention to, because something happens in this story. And again, keep it in context that all of the legal scholars and the Pharisees are saying, take a look at this guy. This guy's breaking the law on the Sabbath. Take a look at this. This guy's healing the guy on the Sabbath. Take a look at it. He goes and eats with sinners and people of, oh my goodness, look at this guy. And they know everything, don't they? They're the religious, and they know the rules. They know the right. They know the wrong. Just keep that in mind. So the four things he realizes. The first thing he does is that he realizes that he has wronged his father. He realizes. It says in the New Living Translation, I'm sorry, that and when he came to his senses, when he came to his right, when he came to his right thinking, when he came to his right mind, when he started to see things clearly. And sometimes that's why people are hurting and they say, help, help. And I say, you got to, in my mind, I'm saying, hey, man, I'm praying for you. In my spirit, I'm saying, you got a little bit more down to go. Tell you, don't be scared of doing that, ladies and gentlemen, people out there. Sometimes that's someone you love so much that you keep on candy appling. Let me explain what that means. That you keep on enabling. They need you to say, look, this is it. I love you, but not your behavior. I love you, but not your behavior. Because they're going to tell you, oh, yeah, well, how can you say that you love Jesus, but you don't love me the way I am? I do love you. I even love you the way you are. I don't like your behavior. I want that to change. And only Jesus can change that. Amen. So the first thing he does in order to come back is that he realizes he's down, he's eating pig pods, and he's saying, he realizes that, man, even my father's slaves are living better than me right now. Even my father's servants are living better than me right now. What have I done? Sometimes it takes you to be on a park bench to be able to say, God, can I get a little change? God, can I get a little change in my life? God, I'm tired of suffering. God, it's been 18 years of running and running and running and of avoiding everybody who loves me. Can I get a little change? But first you got to realize that you've come down that low, or that you've paddled that, or stopped paddling and drifted that far back. He would have never come to his father first. That prodigal never would have come to his father. The servants' fathers, they were even living better than them. In the book of James, chapter 1, verse 17, it says to it, whatever perfect and good gift comes from God above, who created all of the heavenly lights, unlike them, he never casts shifting shadows. If God said it, he's going to do it. He's not going to go like this to you and then say, oh, I took that away. If God says it's yours, it's yours. If God makes a promise, he keeps it. Somebody say amen. Amen. So the first thing he does is that he realizes that he did wrong. He realizes his present condition. He realizes his present situation. The second thing is in verse 18, he repents. He repents. He says, I have sinned against heaven and against my father. I have sinned against heaven. I did what was wrong. I know better than this. I mean, when a man says, I have sinned against heaven, he's saying, I've got a knowledge of heaven. I've got a knowledge of godly things. And what I've done is not right. It's not godly. It wasn't the right thing to do. I sinned against heaven. God did not put me on this planet so that I could just be a waste. God didn't put me here so I could be in sadness and depression every day. I listen to me. I read something off of one of my devotionals. I love the one line just locked my heart and soul. He says, listen, sometimes I'll get up. I'll feel sad. I'll find something I want to feel bad about, or something has gone wrong, and the car didn't start, or the gas, or this, the tire, or whatever, and I'll go right into negative. He says, and we often feel that when something is bad, well, I must do something good so that I can change this paradigm or this dynamic. Well, how about if instead of doing something good, I find something negative and subtract it out of my life? We're always trying to do. When you are depressed and sad and run down and tired and beaten and frustrated, the last thing that you want to do is trying to pull some more energy and do something else. What you have to do is say, this thing I cannot change has got to go. This thing I cannot change has got to go. You that have been haunting me, you've got to go. You've got to get out of my life. I can't change you, and I no longer want to worry about you. So sometimes it's not the addition of something, but the removal of something that had been haunting you. And it's the devil that does that so he can destroy your life. Repentance. Many people are metanoia. Metanoia. I don't know Greek. I'm not going to lie. I got books. I got books that know Greek. A metanoia, as I looked at that, a repentance, what does it take? Most people think that, well, you know, it means that I stopped doing what I was doing. Right? I found out that it's three things. God made us in his image, body, soul, and spirit, or intellect, emotion, and will. Right? Power to choose, power to think, and power to feel. Right? And so as I thought of repenting, I think of a train. And the train is going that way. And I'm going that way. I'm going that way, right? In my intellect, I want to go that way because that's the way I want to go. Then my emotions kick in, and I'm looking out, and I'm saying, I'm going the wrong way, number two. I realize I'm going the wrong way. How many of you ever realized I'm going the wrong way? But have you done number three? Because in repentance, there's three things. Number one, is that intellect? I want to go that way. I made a choice in my own intellect and my reasoning. I'm going that way. Number two is that in my emotions, hey, wait a minute. This is the wrong way to go. This is hurting. Then if you stay there, what do? You keep going the wrong way. So the third one is your choice of will. You jump off that train. Then there's another thing, and this is a freebie. You head back to where God is. Does anybody follow me? So many people say, I repent of that. I said, I'm sorry. I said, I don't want to do that no more. It's not that. You've got to not only stop doing it, but walk away from it. Get away from it. Get away from the people that will drive you to it. So many people I see in repentance, and they say, no, man, man, I was heading down that road, and I realized it was the wrong thing, and I stopped. You stopped and did what? And stayed on the same train with everybody that's going to hell? You got to get off. You got to make a choice and get off. So the prodigal son sees that he's got to repent. Not only does he need to stop feeding pigs, not only does he need to stay in a distant land, but he's got a choice to make. I will go back to my father. Anybody see the three points of repentance there? And the fourth, a third one is to return. He returns to his father. And he arose and came to his father's house. When his son really changed his mind, he was willing to change his direction. I want you to know something. Ephesians 2, 8, 9, and 10. For by grace all ye are saved through faith and not of your own selves. It is the gift of God. It's not because of anything I did. It's because of what he did. Did you know that it would be shameful? You know, a father is supposed to be waiting like this, and his son is coming. He sees him waiting. He just waits. See where he's coming, right? Maybe he'll put his arms out, but he's waiting, right? Most parents see their kids come back and say, really? What's all that camel stuff all over your feet? Oh, my God, what happened to your ring? You pawned it? You pawned the ring I gave you? You pawned the family ring? What's up with your hair? You stink. You smell funny. You smell like pigs. Oh, my goodness. What's wrong? Right? Listen to me. What did the father do? The father ran to him, which is supposed to be in Judaism, a disgrace. You want to make right, then you come to me. And you tell me where we had our misunderstanding, we'll make it right. But the father did the opposite. He showed love and grace, and he ran to his baby boy. He ran to his baby. And then seeing his baby boy in that condition, he didn't judge him. And I don't want you to judge people. He didn't judge him and say, oh, my goodness, you're dirty, you stink, you look bad, you pawned the ring. What happened to everything I gave you? Look at your clothes. He said, find him a ring. Find him a shawl. Find him some shoes. Find him something. Clean him up. Take him and square him away. Hey, this is my boy. He was lost and now he's found. To understand that you've got to know what it's like to be a parent that has a child that's lost and you turn crazy. And when you see them, I don't sit and wait and say, oh, really? Are you at the park? Well, we'll just come on over. You run to them and say, why'd you do it? Forgive me. I remember seeing my kids and they'll do something wrong. I'm going to beat the daylight. I'm going to kill you for just why? I didn't mean that, but they scared the living daylights out of me. Right or wrong? And so we come on and say that nobody called children and youth. In verse 24, it shows you the final step of the restoring. And the fourth one is that he restored. He was lost, then he was found by his father again. He was lost, then he was found by his father again. Are you with me? He was completely lost, man. I mean, he had lost everything, and he was found. Psalm 103, verse 8 through 13. Psalm 103, verses 8 through 13 says this. For our Lord is merciful and gracious. He's slow to anger and plenty in mercy. He will not always chide, neither will he keep his anger forever. Thank you, Jesus. He hath not dealt with us according to our sins. Aren't you glad? He has not dealt with us according to our sins. Oh, Jesus, thank you for that alone, God. He has not dealt with us according to our sins, according to our iniquities, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward them that fear him, love him. As far as our transgressions are from us, like as a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him. And the fear here is not, it's phobos. Phobos, meaning, I don't want to hurt you, Daddy. I'm sorry I did that. That it's a love. It's not a fear. Like, oh, my God, I'm going to get hit. I'm going to hell. It's like, I love you so much. I'm just hurt. I hurt you. It hurts me that I hurt you. So what a happy ending, right? A son is lost and then he's found. But I told you that there's a little angle on the end, right? What a wonderful miracle. What a happy ending. A son is lost and a son is found. But we and you who know that we can miss a miracle if we don't watch out. We can miss a miracle. And here it is. Don't stand outside and miss the miracle. The older brother. Did you think I'd not say him? Remember, Jesus is telling this to the ones that knew all the law. They knew all that was right. They knew all the right things to do. They knew all the right things to say. They were like lawyers with the law. They were as religious as you can come. And he's telling them about this ungodly son. And Jesus throws in the godly son, or supposedly religious son. Take a look at this. Are you ready? And the Pharisees, in the book of Luke chapter 15, 2, and the Pharisees and the scribes, they murmured, saying, this man, he receives sinners and eats with them. The elder brother needed to repent of his attitude and return to the father's house, just as the younger brother did. He had nothing to do with his brother in returning. He actually said, I'm not going to go in that house. I'm not going to go have happy. Hey, listen, they're breaking out the fatted calf, and they put a ring on him after he sold everything. After he spent, and now they put a ring on him. And then look at this, you ready? So one prodigal, he left the house and he wasted his inheritance. The other prodigal stayed in the house and wasted his inheritance too. Did you hear me? One prodigal left the house and wasted his inheritance. The other one stayed in the house and wasted his as well. Let's take a look. He says, I'm not setting foot in that house. I'm not setting foot as long as my little brother's there. I'm not staying there. He says, I was here on the night he left. I was here on the day that he told Dad he was done with farming and he wanted to do something else. I was here on the day that he walked down the road. He had his inheritance, his bag, and he didn't even look back over his shoulder to wave goodbye to me, the family, or to Daddy. I was here when the people from the town came up and said, "Hey, so how's your son doing in that distant land?" And they mocked my father. They would mock my father saying, "How's your son doing?" Because they had heard. You follow me? I was here on the day that he went to the big city. I was here on the nights that Dad would cry. I would hear him sobbing in the other room. I could hear my father sobbing because this little brat was gone. I was here. I was here. And now he comes home and everything is just thrown out for him. I want to ask you, who do you think was lost? Is anybody following me? So here's one who is obviously lost. And I told you, he's selfish. He found his way away. He got separate. He lost everything. He just gave everything up. He's finally starving and hungry. Comes back to his senses and come home. But there's another one who's right in the house. And all he's got was, "I was there. I was there for the farming. I'm the one that did all the work. I'm the one that did all that. I was there on the day that he left. I was there when he didn't say goodbye." He could tell you everything he did wrong. Are you following me? When all the father really wanted was a relationship with them both. Which one of us parents or brothers or sisters or friends, if we have a friend that's dying, a friend that's hurting, aren't going to reach out and love on them? Which one of us, if they finally say, "Hey, man, I love Jesus. I came to Jesus today," aren't going to be happy and say, "Hallelujah. This one was dead and now he's alive." So one prodigal, he was a rebel, and the other one, he was a religious one. Are you following me? They both needed to come to Jesus moment. They both needed to come to their father moment. So my thought for you today is this, my PowerPoint. Don't stand outside and let the miracle go by because somebody's inside that you think doesn't deserve to be here. Let's not be judges and jury, but know that the mercy of God is from everlasting to everlasting, that God loves us all, that he gave his life for us, even while we were yet sinners, still caught up, trapped, and addicted in the mire, in the pit. God reached down his hand, sent his son so that he could deliver us up and set us free. All the father wanted from his children was a relationship with the lost one and with the religious one. Amen, church? All he wants now, man, with you, as you go through these seasons, maybe it's getting a little far away, I haven't been back, church, I'm staying out of fellowship, let's get together more. Let's get in touch. Listen, more important than calling me is calling Jesus. More important than calling me is calling Jesus in prayer. One of the most powerful prayers I heard Pastor Sherry say this a week ago is quietly speaking to God when he says, "God, it's just me. Good morning again. I feel like garbage, but I'm getting up." And just that's, those are the most powerful, man. It's just you and God. It's not to impress. It's just like, I need you. Oh, Lord, I need you. Debbie, would you just play something on the panel for a second, please? Hey, I want to end with this. First of all, is there anyone out there? I know the people here, you can respond by raising your hand. Is there anyone out there? I just want you to raise your hand. You can do it in your home. Maybe you have to raise, you got to raise a husband hand or a daughter's hand, or you've got to raise somebody's hand in your family and let them know that, you know, it's time for us to get right with God. Not only in religion, not in falling away, but we need a relationship with God. I want to ask you now, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, that he loves you and that he cares for you so much, and that you would know that he is God's son, that God sent him down so that he could be our Savior. He isn't judging you right now. We're living in a time of grace. His grace is as far as the heavens, he said, and he's waiting for you. It says he doesn't judge us according to our sins. He's not judging us according. Thank God for that. That means that there's an open door. I can open and say, okay, okay, if this is an open moment, then okay, here I am. I'm messed up and I need help. If you're somebody out there and you need to accept Jesus, I want you to pray this simple prayer with me. And then text us back, you know, and get back to us, and we'll talk to you about it in detail. If you a phone call or something like that, whatever we need to do. Okay, it doesn't have to be texting. It can be live. Say, Father in heaven, come into my heart. Forgive me of my sins, Father. I receive you by faith as my Lord and my Savior. I believe, Lord, that you are God and that you were crucified for me, for my sins. And so I want to receive you so that I can be the benefactor of your righteousness. Father in heaven, I'm sorry for the things I've done wrong. Please help me to make a decision to do what's right. Not only stop, but make a decision and turn away and walk away from it and walk towards you. Father, I pray that you be my Lord and my Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Is there anyone in this room now? You just want to raise your hand and say, hey, you know what? I could always get closer to God. And I need to thank you. Thank you so much for raising your hand. Thank you. Thank you. Father in heaven, I thank you for each and every one that's here today. I pray that you'll be with them, Lord, and just bless them and just keep our hearts strong on you and knowing, Lord, that you don't want us to be prodigals who are lost, and you don't want us to be a religious one who is lost either. You want a relationship with us, only with you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you very much. Hey, now it's time to receive the Lord's tithe and offering. We have somebody who's going to be wearing a glove, who's going to be wearing a glove, and he's going to be passing this around. He's going to be wearing a glove. He's going to be passing this around. And since it's just kind of short here, we're going to be able to reach over, okay? And if you have an offering out to give. Now, this is one way right here. Okay, give it here at church if you want to come. We can have up to 25 people and maybe a little bit more if you can find some safe seating, and we will help you and have some directions for that. Always come and bring your mask with you, please. Okay? And thank you very much. Father in heaven, we thank you for this offering. We thank you that we don't got to give. We get to give. We thank you in Jesus' precious name. We thank you for all our pastors, God, and pray that you would be with them. We thank you for all the hard work that they're doing behind the scenes that can't even be seen. Everything that we're learning, this is all new to us. There's some who are doing nothing, and we're trying to do it all. So we're learning. Be with us, Lord. Now bless this offering for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, my brother. Hey, I just want to tell you also that, you know, some of you may say, you know, I'm not there, so I can't give. There's another way to give. You can send a check to City Limits Assembly of God at 302 on Ridge Avenue, R-I-D-G-E, and then put Avenue, Allentown, Pennsylvania, 18103. Or you can go to our Facebook page now, our City Limits Facebook, Assembly of God, our City Limits Assembly of God Facebook, and put it on there. There's a textable. It's called textable. It takes it out one time. It's not a recurring thing unless it's done by you. Okay? And so I want you to join us in that way. Very soon now, we'll be having a website that'll have a donation link, and it'll make it all so much easier. But for now, just if you could just please try to do it that way, okay? Thank you so much. It should be on the screen. I can't see you anymore. But if there's any prayer requests, please send them to citylimitsag@msn.com, and we will get back to you. We're going to have a time where we're actually going to sit, and we're going to pray for your prayer request and pray for them openly. So I want you to send them. Now, that might mean that maybe there's something private, maybe something personal. I just put down family, unspoken, sickness, unspoken, or whatever, okay? We're not going to say anything private online, okay? We won't say anything private, okay? Thank you so much. God bless you. Father in heaven, I thank you for this morning. I pray that your love and your mercy would guide and direct us, Lord, as we leave this place this day, Lord God. We We thank you for your blessings. We thank you. We pray for all these rallies and protests and people getting hurt. I heard that there was up to 700-800 police officers hurt and a bunch of rioters hurt and all kind of things happening. Lord, we need, our country could use a little change too. I think they need Jesus again. And when we started that way, things seemed to be better. So may the peace of God that passes all understanding guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. May the blessings of the Lord all be with you. Keep you safe and healthy. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. As you leave today, I want you to leave nicely. Say hi. Give somebody an air hug. And if you want to fellowship outside, because that's safe for us, okay? That's our new rule. Thank you. Bye-bye. Pastor Jim out. Sit in, miss out.